started.
Second.
Okay, so on January 30th, 2017, at 6:30 p.m., I'd like to bring this joint meeting of the Berkley School, K-8 School Committee and the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee. Roll call of members present. We have from the end, Chris Giliducci, Bruno, Dean Larrabee, Jeff and Naraki, and myself, Dave Patrick.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call this meeting of the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee to order at 6:30 p.m. Due notice having been posted. Let the record show that this meeting is being electronically recorded. And if anyone in the audience also wishes to electronically record this meeting, you should notify the committee at this time. Any such recording may be subject to reasonable restrictions imposed by the chair to the extent permitted under the open meeting law. Roll call. Mrs. Field?
Here.
Mr. Batello?
Here.
Mr. Giliducci?
Here.
Mr. Larrabee?
Here.
And the chair is present. Also with us this evening is our superintendent of schools, Jeffrey Schoonover, our director of business and finance, Lindsay Albernaz, our recording secretary, and Richard Fenstermaker, who is the chair of the Somerset Berkley Regional High School Building Committee. I would ask everyone to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome the Berkley Board of Selectmen, who have previously convened their meeting and are here with us, as well as members of the Berkley Finance Committee, who I believe are sitting in the rear and are also here. They have a quorum, so they've posted their meeting as well. This is intended to be a public forum for the community of Berkley to give you an update on the status of both the Berkley K-8 district and the Somerset Berkley Regional School District, and then to present some issues that face us from a budget perspective. The format is intended to be informal this evening. Unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on your perspective, the open meeting law requires a certain formality because a quorum of each of these four committees is present, and that's why we had to open the meeting formally as we did. But hopefully we'll take a somewhat informal approach going forward. The agenda for the evening is for representatives of the Berkley School District to present district highlights, then for the superintendent of the Regional School District to present district highlights, a report from the chairman of the building committee about the closeout of the building project, and then we'll turn the program over to Mr. Larrabee, who's a member of both the Berkley School Committee and the Regional School Committee, to talk about the high school funding past, present, and future, and the future vision for the district. So with that, I'll turn it back to Mr. Patrick.
Okay, so for an overview of the Berkley K-8 school district, Mr. Lynch, superintendent.
Good evening and welcome, everyone. What I will do is I'll quickly go through the Berkeley's K-8 school structure. And this information was prepared for the Regional Planning Board Committee this fall. And our administrative structure is myself, the superintendent, Jennifer Francisco, and Sarah Kogar as our principal and assistant principal at the community school. That's a pre-K through four school. This building is the middle school, as most of you know, which is 5 to 8, with Mrs. Hebert and Mr. Welch as the principal and assistant principal. Then we have Melissa Donnelly as the director of special services, also known as special ed director. We have Mrs. Andrea Porter, who is our business administrator, and Tim McCarthy is our head of maintenance and buildings. As far as our educational and support staff, at the community school, BCS is the community school, BMS is the Berkley Middle School. And just to run through that quickly, we have 39 teachers at the community school, 17 paraprofessionals, one nurse, two secretaries, three custodians, and one maintenance man. For the middle school, we have 28 teachers, 9 paraprofessionals, one nurse, one adjustment counselor, two secretaries or administrative assistants, two custodians, and one maintenance man. And for the central office, we have this is Tricia Sylvia, who's sitting right over there, my executive assistant to the superintendent. We have one administrative assistant of special ed office. We have one part-time business assistant, and we have Andrea Porter, who wasn't listed in this, but I mentioned her earlier, as our business administrator. For the academic structure at the community school, we have language arts, reading, math, science, social studies. We have adopted the Empowering Writers Program, and most recently, the Bay State Reading Initiative, which is a major initiative to change the teaching style of all of our teachers in grades K through 8. At the Berkley Community School, we also have, as far as unified arts, we have art, music, physical education, computer technology, and library. And at both schools, as far as special education services, we have OT, PT, which is occupational therapy, physical therapy, APE, speech and language, life skills, counseling, and therapeutic support. The middle school structure for academics, we have English language arts, mathematics, which is leveled in grades 7 and 8, depending on their levels. We have science, social studies, and Spanish. Spanish is just in grade 8, and they had that as a regular subject. They don't have it as a unified art. In other words, the students in grade 8 have Spanish every single day, just as if they have science or mathematics. And for unified arts at the middle school, we have art, music, physical education, computer and technology, and in 7th and 8th grade, we also have the engineering lab for informative technology and engineering design. For the academic structure, and I won't read this word for word, but for extracurricular activities at the middle school, for as far as sports that we play other towns, we have soccer, cross country, basketball, baseball, debate team. We do have a musical program. We have homework club, which is two nights a week or two afternoons a week, and we have many other clubs. For the Berkley Public Schools, we do accept school choice students. This slide here says we have 106. However, we have lost 7 of those because 5 of them actually moved to town, which actually happened last year too. Last year we started with 112 school choice students, but actually 12 of them or their families moved to town, which is a nice reflection on us. Without school choice, we would be in dire straits, so to speak, because it does support over $500,000 of our budget. We're paying 8 teachers' salaries out of school choice and 2 paraprofessionals, as well as a technology lease that we've had for the last 9 years now. In fact, that's why we started school choice. And the first year we had school choice, we had 26 students. And at the same time, we started to lose enrollment. And that's happened throughout the state with students and families moving out of state. So we started basically filling empty seats with school choice students. And that has allowed us to keep our small classes at an average of 21 in K to 8. For the academic structure, for Berkley Public Schools, we have level 2. We're a level 2 for the community school and the middle school. As I mentioned, our program of studies, these are the specific subject areas and the programs we use. For language arts, for K to five, we have Storytown. In the middle school, we have novels, and again, I won't read this word for word. For mathematics, in K to five, we adopted GoMath 3 years ago, and the students are showing great gains with that. In the middle school, we have mathematics Glencoe, and in seventh and eighth grade, we have pre-algebra and algebra. For science, in grades K to five, we have FOSS, which is Full Option Science System. That's the acronym for that FOSS. And it's a all hands-on, engaging program. And we have Pearson Explorer in grades 6 through 8. The 6 through 8 program is new this year because it had to be updated with the new state frameworks that came out. For social studies in K to six, we have McGraw-Hill, and we have Prentice Hall in grade 8 and grade 7 as well. And those programs had to be updated as well because of the social studies frameworks being updated. We have Empowering Writers, as I mentioned earlier, in pre-K through 4 for our writing program. And we have Writers Workshop Strategies for Writers 5 through 8, which is Zahner Blauser. We also do a number of novels, especially in grades 7 and 8. For the physical plant, the community school was built in 1962, and there was an addition and renovations in 1992, built in 62. Improvements have been made. There was another renovation project in 2003, and then the boilers were replaced in 2006. For the middle school, this building was built in 2002. And improvements have been made this last spring. The HVAC energy management system, the finance committee supported us in replacing that system because the heat was very inconsistent, as well as the air conditioning, but mostly the heat was inconsistent the last few years. But it's, as a result, it's much more consistent this year. And the governing structure of Berkley K-8, we have school committee members. We have a 5 school committee member committee sitting right before us. We have 1 Berkley school committee member that sits on the Somerset Berkley Regional High School Committee, and that is Dean Larrabee. We also have, Berkley has an additional member voted on by the town at large, and he also happens to be on the committee right here, Mr. Chris Gilarducci, who serves on both committees as well. And then each school has a school council, PTO activities committee, and 1 PTO executive board. And I won't go through all these goals, but basically, we're very proud of our K-8 district. We have very small class sizes comparative to other towns. In this middle school, if we had to reduce our teaching staff, we'd be in serious trouble because we'd be in non-compliance with the state, because we only have 1 teacher at each subject area. For instance, in all of our grades 6, 7, and 8 grades, we have 4 teachers, except for grade 8, but I'll get there. In our major subject areas, we have 1 teacher in science, math, social studies, and English arts. And those teachers have to be certified, and which makes them highly qualified in that subject area. And if we could not reduce that anymore, because say if we reduce it to 3 teachers at each grade level, then one of them would be teaching out of their certification area. And as I mentioned earlier, we do have Spanish. We do have that in grade 8. So in grades 6, 7, and 8, we have 4 teachers at each grade level. 6 and 7, we have 4 teachers at each grade level. And grade 5, we have 4 teachers at each grade level. And again, in grade 8, we have 5 teachers at that grade level. But these are all of our goals here that I work on with the administrative team, and they are approved by the school committee, but I won't read them. because I've gone over most of them as I've spoken. Does anyone have any questions about Berkeley K-8? For either myself or any of the committee members. We have presented our preliminary budget to the school committee. The school committee has approved that preliminary budget, and we're waiting on numbers from the state. We have some preliminary numbers from Governor Baker, which aren't very positive. It's only a $20 increase for each student, but the last few years, the House and Senate have increased that, which we are hoping to do, but we won't find out that until later on this spring. Any questions? Okay, Mr. Larry.
I'm going to call on Mr. Schoon over next.
Oh, okay.
Good evening, everyone. Members of the committees, if I haven't had the opportunity to meet you in the past, I'm Jeff Schoonover, superintendent for both Somerset Public Schools and Somerset Berkley Regional School District. Before I get into this presentation, I do want to acknowledge our high school principal, Mr. Lanziski, who's sitting here in the middle at the first table. So the first thing I wanted to do is just to give everyone an overview of really the enrollment at the high school. Just so we understand what the breakdown is. So what I have here, as of today, we have 1,003 students attending Somerset Berkley. I have the breakdown by grades. You can see from this that we do have a slightly larger freshman and sophomore classes compared to our juniors and seniors. Because of that, the high school has actually experienced some pretty significant growth over the past 2 years. So the 1,003 students that we have today was 959 a year ago, and it was about 930 or so the year before that. So we have seen an increase of about 75 students over the past 2 years. By town, you can see the breakdown here. Somerset sends 683 students to the high school. That's an increase of 39 from 1 year ago. Berkeley has 263, an increase of 2 from 1 year ago. We do, as Mr. Lynch described for Berkeley, the high school also participates in the school choice program. We currently have 55 students attending the high school through school choice. And we do have, and that's a slight increase by 5 from a year ago, and another category. So I believe those two are homeless students who are not residents of Somerset Berkeley or school choice, but they are, as of right now, attending Somerset Berkeley. Based on a prior attendance or residency in one of the two towns. Also, I just want to give you a quick overview. This is the most recent graduation data that we have for a class. The class of 2014, so we understand where our kids are going after they graduate from the high school. 90% of them in the class of 2014 were accepted into an institute of higher ed, either a two-year or four-year college. 83% of that graduating class actually attended a two or four year college. And 2 years later, this is why it's the most recent information, 2 years after they went, so as of the end of this, the 2015-16 school year, 89% of that 83%, they were still attending college. This is a statistic that we normally see that's troubling to really schools and towns throughout the country, that students, when they attend college, they tend to not complete college, but 89% of our students are going there, and at least 2 years later, they are still in attendance. And I will, as Mr. Lynch said, I'll not read all of this to you, but I do want to give just a few highlights. One is our advanced placement program. At the high school, we are offering 12 courses in advanced placement programs. You can see, if you can read all of the courses there, they are fairly spread out among the major subjects. We have a couple in math, 3 in science, 4 in social studies, 2 in English, and 1 in the arts. We have actually 345 students, as of today, enrolled in those 12 courses. What's great about that is, this past spring of 2016, we had 242 students in those same 12 courses who took the AP exam. So So our enrollment this year in AP classes is up 42.5%, which is really astounding for 1 year. And based on last year's scores, 83% of our students scored a 3, 4, or 5. If you're not familiar with AP exams, they are on a 1 to 5 scale. 3 or better is considered passing. So if you earn a 3, depending on which college you go to, you may get college credit for those courses. So 83%, the state average is about 70%, and the global average is about 60%. So at 83%, our students are doing really well on their AP exams. With such an increase in the amount of students we have, we might experience a little dip this year. We don't know, we'll see this summer when we get the results back. That's typical, but our kids are really stepping up to these rigorous courses that we are offering. And by the way, I put at the top here, is college and career readiness, focusing on the and, is not one or the other. So with that, we do have a really comprehensive program of studies, a course of studies that we're proud of at the high school. And I just put some of the electives that we have. So you can see in languages, we offer French, Portuguese, and Spanish. And then in the arts, we have a number of courses ranging from digital photography to ceramics, fashion design. In addition to the major courses in science, we have classes like anatomy and physiology, forensics and biotechnology, business classes and marketing, accounting and finance, and engineering technology from robotics, engineering, design, and some others. Computer-aided design, TV production. I'm not sure how clear that is. But one of the points I wanted to emphasize, currently at the high school, we do have one Chapter 74 program, which is a career and tech ed program that's approved by the state, and it's in marketing. So because of that marketing program, we actually receive additional funding from the state. Our foundation budget increases because of that program that we have. And what we're looking to do, and this is part of our strategic plan, is we're looking to expand those offerings. So what I've included here in the upper left corner is a picture of the robot that our advanced robotics students created and has entered into some competitions. They did quite well with that. In the middle picture, you can see there are some students working on this bridge design. So that is a bridge that they worked on for quite a while in the engineering design class. And then in the lower right, it's a student who is working a video camera. So with the TV production program that we have this year, which is new this year based on using funds from the building project, we are offering courses there, and our students are now producing content. They would be filming events like this, our National Honor Society event last week, athletic events, which the student is at, and now that's going out to local access television, and also going out on our Blue Radio Studios YouTube channel. So if you'd like to see some of the things, great things that our kids are producing, you can see it. But these are the areas that we want to expand into so we can increase our foundation budget and also get some more funding into the school system. And most importantly, give our kids the skills that they need for whatever comes after high school. I want to emphasize here just some of the other awards that we've had. We do have an award-winning marching band. They are the 2016 Mass State Champions and New England Champions in the U.S. Bands competition, Division 1A competition. In 2015, they were the national winners in that same competition. They were the national champs. In the middle picture, you can't really see it clearly, but you might recognize the building. It's the Berkley Community School. And if you've noticed those two big photos, the banners that are in front of the building, those were produced by our high school students last year in digital photography. And in the middle of that picture is one of the students who took those photos. She's jumping up in the air with arms up and picking out her legs. And in the lower left corner, last year our students put on a phenomenal production of Beauty and the Beast. They are so talented, and really in the fine performing arts, they bring pride to the school each and every time that they perform. So beyond the classroom, I just wanted to, as Mr. Lynch also shared about Berkley, some of the opportunities for students to engage in things outside of the class. So in athletics, and these are the 2015-2016 athletics participation numbers. You can see in the top, or in that middle row, the white row, is the number of sports in each season by boys and girls, and also the number of participants each season by gender. So you can see, even just in the fall, we have about a third of our students in the high school who are participating in some athletic sport in the fall. And the numbers dip a little bit as we go through the year. The fall is the busiest season, but we do have a very active school community for students participating in sports. Right below that, I just wanted to acknowledge one other sport. We have unified basketball and unified track. If you don't know what unified sports are, it's affiliated with Special Olympics. It matches students with intellectual disabilities with students without intellectual disabilities. They're teammates and they compete against other teams. If you haven't seen a unified sports game, I highly recommend it. It's absolutely amazing to see. And in extracurricular activities, we have so many. I listed a few of them, but just we have many opportunities for students to engage in other things and other learning opportunities outside of the school day, the regular school day. And I'm proud to say that this past year, this fall, based on the spring 2016 achievement results, Somerset Berkley was named a level one high school in the state. And this is based on growth or increases in our achievement scores on MCAS in math, reading, and science. It's also based on our growth scores. So not only are kids achieving well, but they're also growing at a higher rate than their peers. We're closing achievement gaps. We have a high participation rate, and our graduation rate is also very high. And actually, our dropout rate is very low. Now, we recently had, the school committee recently approved a strategic plan. These are the four goals. The first goal is on student learning, developing, promoting 21st century skills. The second is on teaching. The third, increasing parent and community engagement. And the fourth one, supporting the goals of the district by improving efficiencies, developing key performance indicators, and constructing a model of sustainable funding. And I know that's really the reason why many of us are here tonight, so I just wanted to call special attention to this one. This is the sustainable funding model, and these are the four of the key actions that we have in this. But we do want to pursue new revenue sources to fund the district's needs. I talked about that a little bit with some of the grants, particularly with our career in tech ed. We can pursue federal Perkins grant funds. I talked about the Chapter 74. See if there's a way that we can also build some more tuition-based programs. Creating a facilities plan. As you know, the building is still very new, but we need to make sure that we are planning for the future and maintaining what we have. Maintaining or improving community perceptions of the value of the district services, and also using data to identify efficiencies, cost reductions, and new sources of revenue. And this is reviewing all of our district operations, from regular and special education to transportation to our programs of studies and our course schedule. So those are the things that we're looking at as we make sure that we have a sustainable funding model for the two communities, for Berkley and for Somerset. Okay, before I turn it over, are there any questions for me or for the committee related to anything with Somerset Berkley? Okay, thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Rich Fenstermaker. I'm the chair of the Somerset Berkley Regional High School Building Committee. And we are finally near the end of our work. So I'm going to just give you a brief overview of the committee and how the work has come around to date. The building committee was appointed back in October 2010. We have 20 members on the committee from representing both the Berkley and Somerset communities. Many of the members, it seems like an unwieldy size of a committee, but it was really a great committee because we had people from all walks of life, if you will. People brought in certain expertise to the project from their, from either their day jobs or their experience. So it was a terrific committee, and in everyone stayed well-informed throughout the process. The project team also included Skanska USA as our OPM, AI3 Architects, which did the school model school program, and Bacon Agostini were the general contractors, and the MSBA, of course, submitting a large share of the funding as well as giving us support throughout the project. The project that was approved was a little over $82 million. I'm happy to tell you that we came in about $2.78 million under budget. We're into the final phase of review with the MSBA now and should have their numbers in the next within the next 60 days. I think we have a March date with MSBA to get our final payout over the $1.6 million. So of the total project budget ended up being $79,600,000. And the district share for that is going to be $32,985,220 approximately. So it was a great project, and we're happy to be through after, I think, 6 years and 4 months, by who's counting. And that's where we are. I think we've got a great product and a great school, and I hope that all of you that are making your way down there, because there's a lot of opportunities for the community, not just for the students in that building, whether it be through using the walking track, the outside facilities, or even there's even evening classes there you might want to participate in. So I urge all of you to be aware of those things and come down and check the place out. Are there any questions for me? This is a very easy crowd, no questions. All right, thank you very much. Next up will be Lindsay Albernez to talk about
Next is Mr. Larry.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Actually, George Kelly's here.
Are you on the list?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't need this.
You don't need that? Okay.
Hi, my name is George Kelly, for those of you who don't know me. And Dean asked me to sort of do a historical perspective of how we got here, which just means I'm getting old and I've been around. Superintendent Lynch and Superintendent Schoonover sort of gave you a picture of where we are now. And I was asked to show you how we got here. So I'm going to give you a brief overview. For those who don't know me, I was in Berkley resident for 16 to 17 years. I was on the Finance Committee, ended up being Chairman of the Finance Committee. Then I was involved in the Regional Planning Board for the regionalization. After being on the Regional Planning Board, I was on the Regional School Committee, and now I got roped into being on the Regional Planning Board for the district for the K-12. But I'm going to take you way, way, way back many years and then hopefully fast forward you to today. Prior to the regionalization, Berkley never had a high school. What we did was we tuitioned our kids to different communities. At some point, we were tuitioning our kids to Taunton. About 30, 35 years ago, maybe even longer, Somerset approached Berkley because they were in need of students. They had a dwindling student population, and they wanted the Berkley kids to come to their high school. So it was a good fit because they needed students to, they wanted AP English, they wanted to keep their courses, and they couldn't only have two or three kids there to do that. So they wanted the Berkley kids to come over. Berkley didn't have a lot of money, but Somerset really wasn't concerned about that because the power plants were booming, the industry was booming. So Berkley entered into a 25-year tuition agreement at a really, really low rate, per pupil rate. And that was fine for 25 years. And then when that agreement was up, Somerset looked at the agreement and said, wow, you guys are not paying a lot at all. And they were sort of in a different fiscal state. They wanted us to pay more by way of a tuition agreement. And that was where the first sort of funding formula was developed, to how do we pay for that. Somerset wanted a pretty steep increase in our per pupil costs, and clearly Berkley didn't have the money to do that. So everybody got together, this was around 2005, 2006, and we said, how can we put this together to fund the tuition agreement? So we created a stabilization account for the high school. Berkley has a stabilization account for the general fund, sort of a savings account. This stabilization account was created, it was never created before in Berkley, but we did it to put money aside for the increase in the tuition agreement. And Dean's going to kind of go through the numbers, so I'm not going to bore you with all the numbers. He can bore you with those. But what we did is we didn't want to harm the town at all. We weren't going to help the town. We didn't want to harm the town. Same thing with the K-8. We just wanted enough money to pay for the increase in the tuition agreement. So we created a stabilization account. We did an override in the year 2006 to fund that stabilization account. So when the bills came in a tuition agreement, the town was going to pay a portion of those bills. Then in the increase from the tuition agreement increase was going to come out of the stabilization account. And that worked fine. It was a very easy formula. We knew how many students were going to Somerset. It was a per pupil calculation. Very simple. Fast forward a few more years, because that tuition agreement is only a short period of time. Somerset said, hey, yeah, you guys aren't really paying enough. We want you to pay sort of the full per pupil cost. And Berkeley said, yeah, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to try and build our own high school. And Somerset said, oh, that's fine. We'll try and build our own high school as well. So Berkeley submitted a plan to the state to say, let's build our own high school here in Berkeley. Somerset submitted a plan, said, we're going to build our own high school in Somerset. And the state looked at it and said, yeah, we're not going to build two new high schools when you guys have been together for 30 years. So why don't you look at regionalization? We'll build one high school, and we'll give you incentives to do that, and we'll give you a lowering cost. So that's when the regional planning board was put together to see if it was reasonable for Somerset and Berkeley to regionalize at a high school level. And this is where it gets more complicated. When we started to look at this, I was from Berkeley on the regional planning board, and when we first looked at this, I'm going to call it the Abraham's model. There was a model that was done to all regional, any school that regionalized had a specific model, funding formula model. And when we looked at it, it was a sort of a non-starter for Berkeley, because Berkeley would have had to pay an incredible amount of money to get into the regionalization. And the problem with the formula was it didn't take into fact wealth factors from each town. All it did was it took the Chapter 70 money from Berkeley, the Chapter 70 money for Somerset, put it all together, subtracted it, and then divided it per pupil. But when we looked at it, that would be a disparaging thing for Berkeley, because the communities of Somerset and Berkeley aren't the same. When you drive through Somerset, you'll see commercial properties, you see car sales, you see Dunkin' Donuts, you see Home Depot, a lot of industry. When you drive through Berkeley, you see trees and houses. So the wealth factors were different, and how you arrived at that was different. So when we looked at sort of the Abraham's model, we could not do that. So we created a different model. It was never done before in the state, and we created a model that took in consideration the wealth factors of both towns, and so it equalized it. So Berkeley could keep its Chapter 70 money, Somerset would keep its Chapter 70 money, and the formula would then work its way through, so it'd be fair to both towns. So once we developed that formula, which was complicated in and of itself, then we went back to Berkeley and said, well, how can Berkeley fund that? Because it's not there in the general fund. So we had to create a funding formula for Berkeley, and this has even got more complicated, because we had to look at how can we fund this new regionalization through the town funds, and we couldn't do it. So we had to create a Proposition 2.5 override. But we had to create a funding mechanism that wouldn't last for 1 year, it would last for 10 years. So that was really hard, because we had to sort of calculate what the minimum local contribution was, not in 2010, but in 2018. We had to figure out what the Chapter 70 money would be, not in 2010, but 2018. And we had to figure out what the assessment was going to be from a region that wasn't even created yet, and come up with a budget and assessment formulas out for 10 years. Really, really complicated formula, really hard to do. But we came up with this funding formula that was going to last many, many years into the future. And in order to do that, again, we had to have a Proposition 2 override in 2010. And that was on top of the override in 2006. And all that, those two formulas were meant to pay for the increases in the high school education from the tuition agreement and the regionalization. And Dean will get into the numbers, but there's a formula where the town was going to still contribute towards high school education, and then the stabilization account was going to take care of the increases from the tuition agreement and the regionalization. So that's a long, winding road, and it's really complicated formula. The good news is the formula worked out extremely well. The assessment formula from the high school, which the state approved, has been working out well. And the funding mechanism from the stabilization account has been working out really well. Jackie McIntyre, I don't know if she's here, was brilliant in coming up with this formula, because it's worked out really well. Like, if you ask Superintendent Lynch the superintendent Schoolman over what the Chapter 70 money for this year is, they can't tell you. And we had to predict it out from 2010 to what it's going to be today. So it was really complicated. The premise was the stabilization account would grow over time and then would come down over time. And the time is now where the stabilization account is going down. And so that we would need to come up to, the town of Berkley needs to look at this and say, what can we do for another funding formula to last this going to the future? And I think back in 2006 and 2010, the vision I know we a lot of us had was exactly what came to fruition. You have Superintendent Lynch in charge of a K-8 program, which is phenomenal. It is top rate. When the kids go from K-8 to the high school, they are excelling, the kids from Berkley. You have a phenomenal program here in the K-3, and Superintendent Lynch has not only done a great job at K-3, he helped out the region in a time when they needed it. So you've got a great leadership here in town, and Superintendent Schoonover, I don't think they've even scratched the surface at the potential of that high school. With the building and the teachers there, the administration, it's going to be really well. So that's where we are. I want to take you down that road of how we got from 2006 of no high school to 2017 and 18 with a top rate tier one school and a great educational system. And Dean's going to take you through the numbers of where the stabilization account was going to go, where it is now. And I'll take it over to Dean. Thanks.
All right, good evening, everyone. Thanks for spending a portion of your Monday night here with us. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Dean Larrabee, and I've been a proud resident of the town of Berkley since 2007. I know that I still qualify as a newbie compared to many of you in this room, but I love this town and I'm very proud to make my home here. Since 2012, I've served all of you in a variety of roles. I've served for over 3 years as a member of the Town of Berkley Finance Committee, and since May 2015, I've been serving as an elected member of the Berkley K-8 School Committee, and I've also had the pleasure of serving as an appointed member to the Somerset Regional High School School Committee. I'm here with you tonight, as George said, to discuss how the Somerset Berkley Regional School District's operating budget has been paid for by the town of Berkley since regionalization. It is my hope that this explanation will help clear up some lingering questions that many of you may have. During this time that I've served in all these roles, I've learned a great deal about the topic we are going to discuss this evening. High school funding, past, present, and future. I know this is a sensitive and important topic for many of you in attendance this evening. This is such an important topic to me because, as my wife can tell you, it's kept me up more nights than I wish to admit, including last night. And it speaks to something that is very important to everyone in this room, which is the quality of the education our kids here in Berkley receive. And I'm glad at the turnout. Is everybody else impressed? I'm impressed. I believe that by working together, all of us in this room and in the community, that we can craft a solution that works for every one of you who, like me, is proud to make your home here in town. The high school's operating budget is separate from the capital budget that Mr. Fenstermaker spoke about as far as the building was concerned. The high school operating budget pays simply for the operation of the school itself, teachers, supplies, buses, etc. So, midway through the 2012 budget season, as we were preparing for FY13, the Berkley Finance Committee was approached by the Somerset Berkley Regional High School representatives at the time from Berkley, as well as by those who were involved with the original drive to make the building that our kids are privileged to call their own a reality. At that time, the Finance Committee was presented with a model for funding the high school's operating budget that had been built prior to regionalization. The model itself was a figurative three-legged stool. The first leg, as George mentioned, was the twin overrides, one passed in 2006 and the second in 2010. These two overrides provided and still provide the vast majority of the funding needed to pay for Berkley's high school assessment. The second leg was the stabilization account, which began being funded by the overrides prior to regionalization. The stabilization account, as George has stated, was created to assist Berkley with the transition from sending our kids to Somerset High School on a tuition basis to achieving the dream of being equal owners of the state-of-the-art facility. The intent of the stabilization account was to provide a pool of capital that could be drawn upon as Berkley worked towards what the state calls target share, but I'll talk about that in a minute. The third leg was an expected continuation of funding from the town of Berkley. Prior to regionalization, it was modeled that the town was contributing roughly $400,000 a year to educate our high school students through tuition at Somerset High School. This was expected to continue, but it was not continuing as modeled. The Somerset Berkley Regional High School representative was concerned because the modeled third leg of the school was missing. This slide, whoop, don't go too far. I'm new to this, so you're gonna have to bear with me if I pass things. This slide illustrates the original model that was developed. And as you can see from this model, the original run, now mind you, this is the original run of the model, shows that the stabilization account would last until FY18. So target share, there it is. Target share is simply what the state determines is the amount each district should be contributing towards running the district itself. Historically, Berkeley had benefited from above average Chapter 78 due to our demographics, which George sort of spoke about, with the trees and cows and things like that that we have in town, which I really enjoy, by the way. Part of the reason I moved here. Berkeley had benefited from above average Chapter 78 due to our demographics compared to the state averages, but prior to regionalization, the state had indicated that Berkeley would be shouldering more of the load of education financially, and the stabilization account provides some capital for a period of time to help with this transition. As this slide illustrates, I think it does a pretty good job of it too, Berkeley was considerably below target share in the early years of regionalization, but has almost completely reached its target. Early data for this year provides optimism that this will be the year that target will be reached. Now, this concern that the town wouldn't be able to fund its obligation led the Somerset Berkley representatives to take their concern to the Berkley Board of Selectmen, who asked that the Berkley Finance Committee take a look at the issue. The town finance committee started a subcommittee to look at the issue, and eventually a larger committee was formed, including people from the Somerset Berkley Regional High School, the town of Berkley, and the Berkley Public Schools, to take a hard look at the issue. We labored for months with no conclusion regarding the $400,000, the third leg, and whether or not the town should be funding the high school with more capital than it was. There was a great deal of conversation regarding what the true financial obligation of the town of Berkley to fund the high school was. After examining the issue for some time, the finance committee, along with help from the Somerset Berkley Regional High School representative, determined that the town was indeed contributing to the high school education prior to regionalization, but the question became whether or not $400,000 was the correct figure. After much discussion, it was decided that $200,000 was an acceptable figure to begin restoring to the high school beginning in FY14. There were two reasons for this. One, because the finance committee at the time lacked the information to be certain that $400,000 was the actual ongoing contribution amount prior to regionalization. Secondly, and more importantly, $400,000 would have been an exceedingly difficult amount for the town to reallocate to a savings account, given the immense annual budget pressure it felt from all town departments. As many of you are aware, the town of Berkley lacks the type of commercial tax revenue seen in other communities. The $400,000 would have exceeded the revenue available to all downtown departments in that fiscal year, so this was essentially a compromise. At the time, the feeling was the impact to other town budgets, and specifically the Berkley Public Schools, would have been too great to take $400,000 and put it in the stabilization account beginning in that year. Absent any type of compromise, the high school stabilization account, the third leg of the school, would have ceased functioning in FY17. As this slide illustrates, that would be this year. This illustration assumes a 3% growth rate in the assessment for FY18 and beyond. And please note that this is an estimate. With the $200,000 agreed to and funded entirely by FY14 increases in revenue, as to not overburden any one department, the high school stabilization account got some reprieve from the draw rate it had experienced in prior years. But as you can see, let's go back. Funding the $200,000 came with its own set of challenges. The town still has needs that exceed the revenues that we have, which constantly put pressure on the town's luxury of placing funds in a stabilization account. The first such instance came in FY15, when the Berkley K-8 school department was in dire straits and needed $100,000 to stave off a series of layoffs. Chapter 70, which makes up a large portion of the town's available funds to help pay for the K-8 school district, had been increasing at a snail's pace for a few years by FY15. And that's still pretty much the case, Tom, right? Still a snail's pace?
Correct.
Yes. So unfortunately, that trend has continued to present day. In FY15, our K-8 district had reached a point where significant layoffs were inevitable. unless additional funds were made available. After much discussion, a solution was reached to reduce the town's contribution to the high school that year. It was restored to $200,000 the following year, but reduced again in FY17, the current budget year, because of initiatives that required funds the town did not have available from any other source. Since the $200,000 has proven to be a difficult number to honor annually, I see no way that $400,000 would have been easier. So as you can see from this depiction of where we are now, the measure taken 4 years ago allowed the stabilization account to last as long as the original model had suggested it would. It is only appropriate, however, to note that if the town had elected to follow the model as it had originally been drawn up, then as you can see, it would have lasted until FY2021, or 3 years from now. As the earlier model that I showed you did, this model also assumes a 3% growth rate. So, that is the past as I know it, and as many of you lived it. I'm here to present information that I know. Many of the people in this room have heard other explanations and versions of this information, but I'm reporting to you what I experienced personally. We are fortunate to have so many people who donated their time and talents to the town during the time we are discussing. That's a tongue twister, by the way. When I practiced this a bunch of times, that was really tough to get out. I'm sure they, like me, will be glad to answer questions about the events that transpired over the years and brought us to this point. I want to thank everyone who played a part in the past. We are truly blessed to have so many people, both elected, appointed, and those who are employed by the town of Berkley and each of the school districts, who work long hours and passionately labor for what they believe is right and worth taking away from their families and professions for. I think everyone involved will attest that meetings at night feel virtually endless for us. And in the case of some of the Somerset Berkley Regional High School meetings, they are actually endless. I know firsthand that long hours, care, and attention to detail went into every decision that was made along the way, and believe you me, there were many tough choices to be made over the years. Every year, every department in this town does the best it can and functions brilliantly with the resources the town is able to provide. It is no easy task, but I am glad to tell you that what I've observed is a group of people who, like me, are proud to call Berkley their home. So tonight, understanding the past, we begin to chart a path forward. So what do we do now? As you can see, the third leg of the stool, represented in blue, or actually represented in green, the stabilization account, has little funds left within it. And as a result, we are projecting a revenue shortfall for the town of roughly $520,000 before looking at any budget increases for the FY18 budget year at the high school. Increases to the Somerset Berkley Regional High School budget will increase the size of the projected shortfall. The budget season has barely begun, and the hard work for us lies just ahead. Over the next several weeks, budgets will become clearer, and it will be possible to know exactly what the amount of the shortfall, the amount that the stabilization account had been paying for over the past 6 years, but will be unable to cover going forward, is. Some think that there's been little to nothing done so far leading up to this moment, but that is not so. A regional planning board was formed last summer to examine potential savings and educational improvements that could exist if we were to consider regionalization from K to 12, as opposed to the 9 to 12 regionalization that we have right now. This has been a slow process, as it has proven to be a much larger undertaking than those who volunteered for the committee had anticipated. While this process is ongoing, it does not offer any relief for the FY18 deficit we face at present. The high school itself has been examining ways to reduce the assessment for both communities. This examination includes looking at user fees, which is a topic for debate when the proposal is made, George, and a proactive review of our scheduling, which was initiated this year. Both of these initiatives are promising towards offering hope of a partial solution, but it is too early in the budget cycle to determine what impact, if any, they will have on our budget this year. Those of us in this room are together because we appreciate the role we have as townspeople to educate the students of Berkley. It is unfair to characterize this as a high school issue. It is not. It is a town issue. The town lacks the funds to meet its assessment this year, and budget cuts alone at the high school level, given the functionality of the assessment formula George described, would need to be extreme and destructive educationally to reduce the shortfall to zero. It is likely that this deficit, if left unaddressed, could potentially result in budget cuts everywhere. This is not to say the school department is standing by and trying to implore or imply that the town of Berkley needs to fix this issue alone. As you can see from by all the people who are sacrificing their Monday evening, that this is an issue we are all ready and interested in fixing. There are many departments in town other than the school department that have important needs and priorities. That is why this issue appears to be a town issue. It may well affect everyone. Given the time we have, creation of a budget task force, which I've spoken to our Board of Selectmen about, and which I hope could include our new town administrator, representatives from the Board of Selectmen, the town finance team, and the schools, would be a way that we could tackle this as a community as opposed to just a single department. The vision would be to share information and ideas while trying to solve this important issue. This issue extends beyond the purview of both of our school committees. I know that by working together, we can craft and communicate a solution to everyone that will ensure the needs of our school and town are met in the most responsible way possible. Additionally, and this is very important, together we can build a solution that is sustainable. A sustainable solution is something the town of Berkeley needs, and hopefully we can provide. Somerset Berkeley Superintendent Schoonover has a strategic plan for the district, which appropriately has, this is one of its goals, a predictable, affordable, quality education for our high school students, and I believe that's something we can all agree is worth working towards. We will continue to examine K-8 regionalization, and in its absence, areas where collaboration across three districts can benefit all of them. I also anticipate that Berkeley, at the Berkeley town level, an override may be discussed as a potential solution as well. Tonight is about the past and the present. Looking to the future, we hope to have a forum like this one again in late February or early March to communicate a potential solution or possible solutions to this important issue. As we begin this important phase in Berkeley's future, hopefully many of you are thinking of the role you might play in it. I implore those of you who are thinking this way to get involved, stay informed, and let tonight be the first step on your journey, just like coming to an early forum regarding the Somerset Berkeley Regional High School building project was mine. This community needs the participation of its citizens to be successful. I hope everyone will be able to join us for the second forum as we strive towards creating a sustainable long-term funding solution for the students of Berkeley. This will create a future that all of our students can be proud of. And thank you so much for indulging the fact that I had to read this so I wouldn't forget anything important. I'd like to turn it over to Ellen Bruno to provide a brief vision of our future.
Thank you, Dean.
There you go.
So really, our vision for the future is really looking at what our what the presenters earlier tonight gave. We want a successful K-8 district. As Superintendent Lynch described, what we already have is a great K-8 district. Our kids are really ready for high school. It shows when our kids get to Somerset Berkeley, they are exceeding expectations. And often, as Christopher Lucucci points out, our kids are often in the, you know, 8 of the top 10 graduating seniors at Somerset. So we're really creating a really successful 8th grade graduating classes going into Somerset Berkeley. We want to, as Superintendent Schoonover, we want to maintain a level one high school. It's a terrific facility, but we want to continue with the great academics that we have over there, the AP classes, all of the enrichment that we provide our students there, including all the athletics, after school activities. We need to make sure that we can maintain the state-of-the-art facilities. Certainly the brand new building that we have for Somerset Berkeley, but also maintain the buildings we have here in Berkeley now. Dating back to the community school, 1962, having that been remodeled in the early 90s, and now this building having been built now 15 years ago, 2002, we want to make sure that we maintain these buildings so that they can sustain us going forward. Mr. McCarthy does a great job of keeping all of these buildings really up to date. His team really ensures that, you know, when you walk in the community school, you really don't have a feeling that you're walking into a building built in 1962. We want to, our fourth item that we want to focus on, and really Dean looked at this closely with you, was a sustainable funding model for education. George Kelly gave you the background of sort of the historical perspective of how we got to where we're at. Dean brought you more up to date with more current years, but we really have to come up with a sustainable model that works just not only for K to 8, but also for the high school, and really, most importantly, for the town. And this is, as Dean mentioned, really something that we as a town have to address. And to finalize, we really need to make sure that we have a Berkeley K to 12 education system that we can all be proud of. I'm certainly very proud of this education that we are able to provide our students, both K to 8, and then as we take them on over to Somerset Berkeley. certainly an educational system we can be proud of, and absolutely one that we want to give our students, to launch our kids to take on the world once they leave Somerset Berkley. So with that, I'll close up the formal part of our presentation tonight. I'll take my seat and we'll open it up for questions, Dean.
I just wanted to ask Mr. Miller, do you or your board want to add anything before we open it up for adults?
Nothing to add. Thank you. Mr. Hope? I don't know if we can hit it.
Mr. Hoke?
Yes.
Did you have anything to, you or your committee have anything to add?
I do not. We went in attendance if there were questions.
Very good. All right, so at this point, we want to, we have on the agenda questions and answers, questions and answers from the audience. So if anyone, please feel free to ask any questions you may have.
The funding leg, the town fund funding leg, the direct funding leg versus stabilization. It's my impression that stabilization is town funds anyway, but it's just been lump sum once a decade or once 5 years, and then the town funds are something that continue once every year.
That's a good question. So the stool, again, has three legs. The two overrides George had mentioned are a constant funding source that is isolated specifically for the high school, and as you can see, the two red tiers at the top continue on every single year, increasing at 2.5%. The town funds line, which is the blue line, the third leg of the stool, that particular leg is funded by a commitment by the town to fund out of current taxation. So the stabilization, the two overrides are specific funds that were voted on by the taxpayers. Those funds are specifically for the high school purpose and are delineated as such. The town funds come out of the taxation that is appropriated by the town separately from those overrides. And the stabilization balance essentially is the capital that's left in the savings account that was created by the 2006 and 2010 overrides before they were being used to fund the high school education. So does that make more sense, or?
Yeah.
Okay. Like George?
Not really the why. Why you do it all in one path, rather than why you're doing it like top is town funds, which is kind of year to year, and top is stabilization, which is a big lump sum at the beginning. Top being the wrong word.
Yeah, no, I know what you mean. George, you want to take that one? Yeah.
There is no easy answer. It's just complicated. The town funds are basically, if you go back before we did the first override, the real estate taxes, excise taxes, all the revenue of the town goes into what's called a general fund. And before the first override, that was funding all the education, police, fire, highway, library, K-12. When we had the tuition agreement with Somerset, they wanted more money. We had to create an override. So we could have done one of two things. We could have just done a general override, and all that extra override goes into the general fund, and it just all gets mixed in with everything else. But we created a stabilization account for that specific override, just to go into that account, so it was clear for all the taxpayers that money that you were taking out of your pockets, extra money to put into the town, was going to go into that account just to pay for the tuition agreement, which was extra on top of what was already there. So the general fund is just all the money that's going in. The stabilization account, it's funded by taxes, but for that override, for that specific purpose to fund that tuition agreement, then another override to fund regionalization. So that makes the two overrides make up the stabilization account, if that helps you.
It does.
Oh.
Can I ask another question?
Sure.
Of course.
So in your first model, you had our town funds were meant to pay $400,000 per year, and that was despite paying $400,000 per year, the stabilization balance would be reduced at some rate to take care of other costs. And, but in the later slides, we see that we didn't pay anything for the first, directly from town funds for the first 2 years, and then we paid roughly $200,000 for the ensuing years. And despite that, the stabilization dollars fell off a lot more quickly than in the first model. And I'm just, I assume that the stabilization balance was to help pay a fairly consistent cost from year to year. Could you go to the other slide, please?
Which one?
The last one that you showed when you were speaking.
This one?
Yeah. And then the stabilization balance there, you know, drops by $200,000 the first year, nothing the second year, on the order of $100,000 the next year, $600,000 the last year, despite the fact we've made other $200,000. What I don't understand is this significant difference in kind of, there's a sudden $600,000 cost.
So as you look at the cost of, it says SB Reg says that's Somerset Berkley Regional, the regional high school. As you see the increase in the assessment on an annual basis, the funds that we have available to the town don't increase at the same rate as the growth of the assessment has historically. So that's why you see a greater increase in the drawdown and the stabilization every year. Because essentially, when you have the FY15 annual balance of negative $139,676, that isn't going to be covered by anything new next year. And the assessment is going to go up, so it just creates a greater gulf every year. So as George had said initially, the idea behind the stabilization funding model was to build it up for a period of time and then draw it down over a period of time. And that's exactly what's happened, just not exactly the way that it was originally modeled. And of course, this is all, the stabilization funding model, as George has indicated, is very complicated and there's a lot of moving parts. And that's hopefully an explanation as to a portion of, or at least, I hope that explains what you're asking.
So that's, that goes, sudden drops or sudden increases are just external, new, no, large assessments.
It's the growth in the assessment.
Okay.
Yeah, when we modeled the thing, we did it back in 2010, and there's a lot of components. You have to, minimum local contribution. If you don't know what that is the state gives us money and says, in order, once you get this money, you have to at least contribute this minimum amount. So it's called minimum local contribution. And for Berkley, it was going to go up over the years. And so in 2010, we had a model what the minimum local contribution would be when the year, fiscal year 2011, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. Really difficult to do because it all depends on what the state funds and how quickly they want to catch us to target. So we had to just sort of come up with a model what minimum local contribution would be. We also had a model what the assessment would be. Every year the assessment was going to go up. And remember, in 2010, there was no regional high school. So we had to create a budget, put in this new formula, develop an assessment, and then kind of factor in 8 years from now what that assessment would look like. So we had a lot of moving parts to look at in the funding mechanism. So when you look at that, the idea was over the first few years, the stabilization would grow, and then it would start to dissipate. And we couldn't anticipate 8 years out how quickly it would dissipate. So that's where some of the models are different in regards to depends how quickly the state brought us up to minimum local contribution, how quickly assessments increased, a lot of different moving parts, but we did the best we could. I think the formula as a whole did exactly what was intended to do. At some point, the stabilization account was going to drain down to a point where we need to have a minimum funding source, gotcha. If that helps you.
Yes?
Yes.
The assessment for 12 and 13, they're blank. Are those zero?
Yes.
Okay. So what was it before that? Like, what was the town contributing for the high school in 11?
In the years prior to regionalization, it was modeled that the town was contributing $400,000 a year towards the tuition, and that was expected to continue by the folks who developed the original funding model. So if we take a look at that real quick. So that was the original preliminary funding model that was developed by a group of very savvy, dedicated individuals who, again, like George said, had to model out a full decade. One of the things I want to point out real quick is if you look at
The FY17 actual assessment is $2,340,551. So for having the model out that far, they have it as $2,330,355, so it's about $10,000 off. So I wish I could model something out that far and be that close. But at any rate, that said, the original funding model that was developed was expected to last until FY18, because as you can see from the stabilization balance under FY18, we would have gone negative this year. There's a whole host of things that affected their modeling. As George indicated, it's very difficult to model that far out. A couple things that took place is, one, those first 2 years of town funds did not materialize, but as an offset, the Somerset Berkley Regional High School's assessment did not increase nearly as quickly as they had originally thought it would. So the as you take a look at that Somerset Berkley SB reg line, you'll notice that if you compare it to the actuals, that the assessment came up much more slowly, which is part of the reason that we didn't run into this problem sooner. But when the issue was identified and addressed with the partial funding, we were able to get an outcome that was similar to the first model, but not as advantageous as the original model would have been, given all the other external factors that broke in favor of the high school.
Do you know why the money was contributed to those 2 years?
That is an excellent question.
Zero is just seems crazy. Nothing was contributed to that part.
Yeah.
What happened was, I'll just give you my opinion what happened, because I kind of lived through the thing, is the original model that we developed was to freeze whatever the town was contributing back in 2009-2010. So we developed a formula that said the town out of the general funds was contributing $400,000. Once the region was created, what was supposed to happen was there was supposed to be a line item created in the general budget to fund that. It just wasn't. It was nobody's fault. It didn't happen. So that was just our funding model. It wasn't anything set in stone. It was our funding model. So when we went to regionalization, there was no mechanism in place to put a line item on there. And then as we developed this and we saw there was no funding mechanism from the fund, we went back and forth and we said, well, was $400,000, was that a set in stone thing? And it turned out it wasn't. It was just a funding model we used. So we sat down with Superintendent Lynch and we sat down with the finance committee and we tried to figure out what was a realistic figure at that point. Was the $400,000 realistic or not? We thought it was, other people thought it wasn't. So we sat down, we went through the numbers and tried to figure out what would be a general funding model which was appropriate, and we came up with a $200,000 from the general fund to supplement the stabilization account. Because the stabilization account was never intended to fund the entire high school education. It was only supposed to be a piece of it. So that's the best explanation I have. It was nothing that happened. It was just something that the line item wasn't created out of the general fund. And a lot of things were going on with the regionalization at that time, and it was just overlooked at that point. But Ed,
finance committee chair. So I lived issues that are ongoing here. I joined the finance committee back in 2009. When we regionalized we presented the first budget that excluded that $400,000 contribution that Mr. Kelly refers to, he approached the committee, as did Ms. Maycomer, and said, you're not addressing this particular component. There was quite a bit of back and forth with regards to what is this, what was the commitment, et cetera. And resulting from that, at that point in time, because of this back and forth that was going on, right at that particular time, which was 2012, I think it was, Dean Larrabee joined our committee, and I said, Dean, one of the things I want you to do is we spun off a school subcommittee, which was to deep dive school budgets and address the funding model. So he spent an entire year trying to sort through that. Where did the $400,000 come from? What was the obligation? What was the expectation, et cetera? And that's when
the compromise of the $200,000 was derived. So there was that gap of lack of awareness of what that $400,000 was, and then when we brought it in. Also, at the same time, looking back over the years, remember what happened with the Great Recession and the pressures that were on this town to even come close to a balanced budget. There were 2 years or 3 years, don't hold me to the number, where we drew on our general stabilization account just to balance the books. And general stabilization is not a for-purpose account. It's what its name says, it's general. It's like the state rainy day fund. We had to pull into it. We didn't have the tax dollars. We didn't have the revenues to meet the budget. So we were stopgapping with general stabilization. Additional to that, there was the discussion of the adjustment to the foundation budget and the change to the target contribution. That wasn't just high school, that was as well as K through 8 and our other school districts that we subscribe to, the Bowtech schools, Bristol Plymouth, Bristol Aggie. So we watched that. I gotta tell you, that correction was painful. Over the last 6 years, our annual rate of growth in Chapter 70 funds was 0.4%. That's the average rate of that increase in Chapter 70. Prior to that, there were the 2 years from the Great Depression. We saw a reduction in the worst year of minus 6% of Chapter 70 funding. Prior to that, it was a little ragged, but you could see anywhere between 3% increase in Chapter 78 to their community. In the 14 years I was looking at, there was 1 year that was almost 6%. So you went from some, I won't say that kind of growth is outrageous, but it was good growth to flat numbers, basically, with 0.4%. So it's a very complex issue. There is no single simple answer, unfortunately. It's the economics, it's living through the economy, it's doing what we've been needing to do just to survive. Oh, and by the way, during the Great Recession, we had some significant layoffs within our town. So we didn't keep flat with or maintain our headcounts. We incurred layoffs across the town. And I would say that we haven't recovered at this point yet either. We've been holding our own. And this year, this is where we got the tough challenge with regards to our funding profiles. Thank you.
So just to be clear, is it fair to say the $200 that you didn't put in there just used to pay the rest of the budget, like for the town? That's where that money went. Nothing was put in for the school. So it went to fund whatever else the town needed at that point. Is that what you're trying to say? Basically?
It was in the general fund and it funded town government.
It got pushed out, like it was that money, so it got kind of forgotten about, and then we just spent all the money on other things for 2 years. Fair to say.
We didn't know of the commitment first.
Right, understood.
And then secondly, it went into the general fund.
General fund.
So the questions for me while I'm standing.
About where the $400,000 was. During the regionalization process, there was a disaggregation of the budget, and $400,000 was the figure, which is why the model was built that way. I understand and respect that the town had other financial priorities, that they chose to spend it differently, which was totally within their legal right to do, to not follow the model. But I just need to be clear that It was 400, it was actually 420,000 when it was disaggregated. When we did the model, we did 400,000. The town had other priorities, and I respect that. I mean, if you live here, you know that everything's on a shoestring, and that's why I appreciate what Dean said, is it's not a high school issue, it's a town issue. When I was involved in this before, Berkley doesn't have a spending problem, Berkley has a revenue problem, and I believe that to be true, and I think that the most important thing, as frustrated as I am, that the funding model was not followed, I think the important thing now is to figure it out going forward.
Are there any other questions?
What are the options going forward?
So as I mentioned in the presentation, at this stage of the game, I think the formation of a budget task force, including members of the town side government as well as the school side government, to take a look and actually come up with a solution that we can present to the taxpayers is something that we're striving to do. As I mentioned before, it's still very early in the budget season. So at this stage of the game, some of the initiatives that that we're looking at the high school to try to reduce the assessment really haven't had an opportunity to provide us with the kind of data that we would need to determine if there's any actual savings. So at this moment in time, it's tough to determine exactly what the shortfall will be, but we're hoping to come back and see all of you and hopefully some more folks as well in February or March so we can present that information and start talking about what we see as an actual solution to this problem for FY18 will be. As I mentioned, an override is a possibility of something that we can discuss, but we're not going to be discussing that here this evening. And you know, certainly we're open to suggestions and ideas, and you know, we do have a new town administrator, so I'm actually very excited to work with that individual because he brings a whole host of experience and time in municipal government that I think will benefit the town. So I'm optimistic that we can work together and come up with a viable solution that we can bring back to all of you very shortly. Does that answer your question? Okay.
The best thing you can do, the best thing you can do is to get involved and be active. I mean, Jackie, I'm glad she's here. The model that was created, she worked so hard on that, and it's so complex. And if you look at what happened, is she was almost right on the mark with everything. And to do that is an incredible feat. But she did that as a person and a member of the town of Berkley. So just get involved. The more people that are involved, the more ideas you have, the better the solutions are, and you can go forward and make a huge impact by just getting involved and coming together with all your personal experiences and your professional experiences. Throw ideas around. And I mean, we've worked so hard on that formula, many, many hours, but the best thing is to get involved. Go to the school committee meetings, go to these forums, spread the word around, get some professional accountants out there who are really smart, and go to the finance committee meetings. But getting involved, I think, is the best way to move forward, to come up with solutions, because there are solutions. They can be found, and they will be found. And you have great foundation here to move forward with. And the town, I think, has a great, bright future, because we can't give any better gift than the education, I think, for our students and for the town. When you educate kids on how to problem solve, when they come back to the town as adults, the town grows and becomes great. So I think get involved, give some ideas, give your professional experience, and give your time. I think that's the best answer. Thanks.
I just wanted to say something on behalf of our board. Just to make it clear, Jackie had pointed out that the town chose to spend money a different way than the funding that was modeled out. That actually wasn't the case, just so people are clear. During that time period, there was no additional firefighters added, or police added, or town administrators added, or secretarial added. In fact, there were some cuts. It's my understanding that, and I think Dean had referenced this earlier, it was my understanding that if that had been funded, there probably would have been some significant cuts in K-8,
And as we've heard tonight, K-8 is thriving. We all equally care about K-8. We care about the high school. But at that time, just to be clear, because I don't think you meant to imply it, but I think somebody could understand that it looked like maybe the Board of Selectmen and town meeting was spending like drunken sailors, which wasn't the case. As a matter of fact, we were trying to keep things as safe and as funded as we possibly could. Again, there were no significant additions. We weren't going out trying to take from Peter to pay Paul. It wasn't like that at all. Again, I think this was something that was done in all likelihood to prevent some pretty serious impact on K-8.
Yes.
So, in both the model and in what actually happened, the stabilization balance was supposed to, the stabilization account was supposed to be empty in the same year, like the target was met, whether coincidentally or not, right? And in the model, we were paying out of town funds $400,000 a year, and since then we haven't even been paying half that, it turns out. So what happened to make the stabilization account last as long as it did?
I apologize if I wasn't clear on that. There were a number of factors that led to the outcome that you see. The first one is if you take a look at the SB reg line, you'll notice that the increases that were originally modeled were not the increases that we saw. Initially, Mr. Kelly, who was our representative at the time, did a phenomenal job, whether you could take that personally or by coincidence. He did a phenomenal job of keeping the assessment increases low, and that was due to a number of factors. But nevertheless, that slower than expected growth in the assessment is really the leading cause as to why the town was able to contribute less and still have the same outcome.
And sorry, could you just clarify again, who makes that assessment, the SB rate assessment?
The assessment comes from a model that
I mean, is it the state?
No. George had mentioned that initially they had built a assessment model, and it's in here. Bear with me. There it is. So this is the assessment model that was developed by the group that George was a member of, and several others as well. This is how the assessment for the high school is divided up amongst the member communities.
Well, what happened is the Somerset Berkley region sends a bill, which is the assessment, to the town of Berkley to pay that bill. And that assessment comes from
this
kind of a complicated formula. But every quarter, I don't know, is it quarterly that they send a bill or?
Monthly.
So monthly, the assessment comes up for fiscal year, and they send the bill to Berkley, and Berkley pays that bill monthly. So it comes from the region, the assessment comes from the region. And that has to do with the budget and Chapter 70 and all the different aspects.
The assessment formula is actually contained in the regional agreement, which governs all aspects of how the regional school district is run, and that regional agreement was approved at town meetings in both Somerset and Berkley. So this assessment formula is part of the regional agreement that we have in place and that we follow in preparing our budget and then the assessment to each community as to what their respective shares of the budget is after we've made various credits to the actual budget, particularly with respect to Chapter 70A, but we do have certain other credits that we also apply before we issue the assessment to each of the two communities. And at this point, there are actually two components to the assessment, which is the operating budget and the capital assessment. And there was a question that was asked earlier as to why there was such a significant drawdown on your stabilization account in this past year. And there are various reasons why that happened. We had very low budget increases for the first 4 years of the regional school district. We actually had a 1.9% increase the
first year in the budget, a 0.6% increase in the second year, a 0.3% increase in the third year, and a minus 1.2 increase in the fourth year. So in the fifth year, which was this past year, that kind of caught up with us. And there were various reasons why it caught up with us. One was because there had been very low increases in the budget in previous years, but also because we began to have the full load of the debt service for the new high school. We had been doing short-term borrowings at extremely low interest rates and not really making any significant bond payments in previous years. But I believe Lindsay, our Director of Business and Finance, will agree that really our bonds have largely been issued. We have one small bond issue that is remaining, but essentially this last year's budget reflected pretty much what the annual capital expense is going to be for the new high school. So those were the factors that led to why the increase was higher in this past year, why the drawdown on your stabilization account was much higher than it had been in the past. I want to add one more thing, since I always take this opportunity. I really get the opportunity. My name is Rick Pierce. I've been the chair of the Regional School Committee since its inception, and I really like to take advantage of the opportunity just to echo some of the things that have been said about the contribution that Berkeley students make to the Somerset Berkley Regional High School. They're an extraordinary group of students. They're leaders in their classes. They're leaders academically. They're leaders in sports. You heard about our unified sports program, which is something that we're extremely proud of, where our students reach out to our students with disabilities and team up with them. And it's an incredible experience for the kids with special needs. The leadership for that program largely came from students from Berkeley. So you have a tremendous amount to be proud of. We all have a tremendous amount to be proud of in terms of being two communities that have come together and really created a great high school. We have a great superintendent with a lot of vision who is bringing in outside analytics to see how we can improve and also at the same time save money. So we are very conscious of the burden that education places on both of our communities. Somerset is also experiencing budgetary concerns with the closing of power plants. So it's something that we're very much aware of, and we're hoping that we'll all be able to work together to come to a solution that everyone is going to have to live with. So if there are no further questions, and we're certainly happy to take any other questions that you might have. Yes?
I have a question. Right now you're saying this year we're expecting a bump in the increase, 5%.
This year, the one that's actually already in place.
Right, and a lot of that comes from starting to pay on the bonds better. What about the future? Do you see that increase happening again, or is that?
Well, as far as the capital costs, we're sort of now at a plateau. It will be slightly higher with our final bond issue, but that's probably only going to be about 1.5 million. So we have about 30 million bonded, and we have about 1.5 million left to bond. Another very positive thing that I'd like to share with you is, before Mr. Larrabee was on the committee, and he was on the finance committee in Berkeley, he used to quote Lou Gehrig to me. He would say to me, you're the luckiest man on the face of the earth, because we have had a very, very favorable interest climate. And when we were proposing this new high school to both communities, we had to use an interest rate which was kind of somewhat conservative, and
a rate that our financial advisor suggested that we use to project what the overall cost of this project was going to be. And so we were using a rate of around 3.75 to 4%. We've been able to issue some of our bonds under 3% and other bonds right around 3%. So in fact, we've saved several million dollars in interest and principal costs over the 20 years of the pay down of the bonds, which we really can't claim a lot of credit for. It's a factor of the interest climate that we've enjoyed for so many years, but it really has had a significant impact and is going to save us $3 or $4 million on the overall cost of the project.
Well, barring anything unforeseen, you don't expect the increase in operating budget to go up
the capital budget. It's pretty much
the operating.
Turn around. Are we going to go back to the 0.6, 0.3, or are we going back to the 5.3?
So he's asking if we're going to see an increase close to what we saw in FY17.
We're working on our budget now, and we're doing everything we can to keep it significantly below that. The pressures on public education these days are incredible. It scares me every time the legislature goes back into session because they continue to put new obligations on our high schools, our administrators. The governor got a lot of credit for being a leader in dealing with the opioid crisis. And within that legislation, there were several obligations that were imposed on school districts. As of next fall, we have to interview every student and determine whether they have used drugs or alcohol or are users. So that's a burden that our district is going to have to assume. And obviously, it takes time away from existing staff, or requires some additional staff to fulfill these obligations. So, but we're very conscious, and we are certainly expecting that we're not going to have an increase this year at that level. There are no guarantees, but we're working to keep it well below that.
So for Berkley, is it? It's conceivable to think that there's a $400,000 deficit for the foreseeable future, the next 15, 20 years. Like, if that's how that was supposed to be funded for the last 15 or 20 years, you know, is it anywhere from 200 to 400,000? Like, how do we judge what that number may be, or what that number is in the foreseeable
future? So the part of the solution has to be, how do we come up with the answer to that question in a sustainable way? Now, one of the reasons that the gap is existing in and of itself is if you had a savings account at home that had $1 million in it, and you constantly used that over a period of years and drew it down to zero, it wouldn't replenish itself. So obviously, there are solutions out there, such as an override, for example. You'll notice those when we looked at that other chart, those red legs are the strongest legs and the most consistent legs. So an override is a source of funding that replenishes itself on an annual basis. So it doesn't create a drawdown in the same way the stabilization account does, because it's constantly replenishing itself. There are probably other solutions that we can take a look at, and we just really haven't had the opportunity to examine solutions yet, but hopefully that fiscal task force will give us an opportunity to look at other types of solutions as well. But that's the reason that it won't just constantly be $400,000 every year. Does that make sense?
Yep, thanks.
I wanted to add one clarifying comment to Mr. Pierce, because I want to make sure everyone understands this.
In the capital budget comes the assessment for the school building. That is in no way, shape, or form tied or paid from the high school stabilization. That is a separate Prop 2.5 override, debt exclusion to pay for the school. It's not part of the problem. It's not part of what we're discussing tonight. So take the high school building out of the equation. That's paid for, that's covered by the funds that you all voted for. This is an entirely different thing.
Thank you.
Earlier this evening, I was a bit remiss. I introduced our high school principal. I failed to introduce our director of business and finance for Somerset and Somerset Berkley, Lindsay Albernaz. And I know Lindsay has just a few statements to share regarding the budget topic.
Thank you, Mr. Schoonover. I'm known as the budget lady. That's my official nickname. So one thing to consider with the regional school district is that we are a separate school district. We are responsible for paying 100% to insure the properties, to pay for unemployment, to pay for workers' compensation. We have to pay for any sort of contractual increases that are for our teaching staff, our paraprofessionals, our admin assistants, our maintenance and custodial crew. Those are all sort of fixed things that you really don't have a lot of wiggle room on as far as an increase. So to answer your question is, what percentage increase do you see this coming in us? Health insurance is another huge one that we're seeing an increase on in FY17, and it's gonna go up in FY18 too. So when we say, a 5.3% increase, we're not asking for, let's buy every, sophomore, junior, a new car. It's not frivolous things, it's really considered fixed costs that we have very little wiggle room with. And when you start looking at increases that are about 2.5-3% for those fixed charges, and you also want to see some new initiatives happening, you have to pick and choose because you can't do both. So we are looking at other initiatives and scheduling and seeing if there's cuts that we can make. We're seeing if there's new initiatives that we can fund with other revenue sources, such as user fees. And nobody wants to see, I know Berkeley K-3 has user fees for some of their activities. It's a difficult conversation to have, but we might be having to have that conversation sooner than we want and to start charging students to participate in athletics, to participate in clubs. It's just the nature of the beast to keep the budget stable and to have a percentage increase that's reasonable for both communities, because it does affect both. So I just wanted to share that. A lot of them are fixed charges and contractual obligations, including transportation, that we are responsible for funding. So.
Are there any other questions?
Is there a way we can get a copy of the slide?
Yeah. It's self-distributed.
I have it.
Website? We'll put it on the regional school district website.
Thank you.
Any other questions? There are no other questions. I think we can close our meetings. Entertain a motion to adjourn the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee meeting.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Patello and seconded by Mrs. Field. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Thank you, everyone, for coming.
Second.